The usual lunch special, Charles? Yeah, Damien, but no crab rangoon this time. Trying not to eat so many carbs. Whatever you say, dude, Damien said, ringing him up. To say that Charles ate a lot of Chinese food probably wouldn't put his problem in perspective. Charles had been lucky when the pandemic hit. He was a work-from-home computer tech who rarely left his house anyway, so working on projects from his apartment was pretty par for the course. He'd been getting lunch at Damien's for the better part of 8 years, and they had the best Chinese food within walking distance of his bungalow. Though COVID had put an end to him dining in, it hadn't stopped Charles from getting his fix. Quite the contrary, it had only made it worse. Charles ordered from Damien's 3 times a day. Breakfast was egg drop soup, and early morning rice at 10. Lunch was General Tso chicken, around 2 o'clock. Dinner was beef and broccoli with house soup and salad at 10, and was also the last delivery that Damien's made for the day. Charles honestly couldn't remember the last time he had cooked a meal for himself, and it just seemed easier to buy takeout. His programming job paid way more than he needed, especially after a lot of his coworkers had quit, and Charles was enjoying his shut-in lifestyle. When he heard the knock on his door, he rolled away from his keyboard and went to get his lunch. It was the short, dark-haired guy this time, the one who looked a little like Bruce Wayne. He didn't speak a lot of English, and Charles told him thanks as he took his food inside. Damien's only had about 3 delivery guys. The nerdy Bruce Wayne was the one who delivered most often. Charles had been hoping it would be Roger, though, the brown-haired Chad who liked to talk about Warhammer, but it appeared he'd have to wait till dinner time to see how he'd placed in last week's tournament. As a shut-in, Charles often had to live vicariously through those who braved the outside world. As Charles looked through the bag, ensuring everything was in there, he smiled as he saw his favorite part of the meal towards the bottom. It was silly, but Charles found that he really looked forward to those buttery yellow little cookies with the fortunes inside. He knew they were far from authentic cuisine, but he liked the cookies ever since he was a kid. Charles had about 100 of the fortunes pinned up on a corkboard, and sometimes he liked to read them and think about their meanings on days he'd gotten them. Had he found someone new when he got that fortune? Had he found untold fortune on that particular day? Looking at them so often was probably why he had noticed the phone number. Want more cookies? Call 1-800-555-2665. He had never really thought about it before. It was probably the number for the restaurant to resupply their fortune cookies. The fact that it appeared on the fortunes, something that were inside the cookies, was a little strange. How would the restaurant get the number if they handed out the cookies? It didn't really make sense for the people eating the cookies to need more cookies. And as Charles sat the food on his desk, he opened the cookie and fished out the fortune as he munched on the little cookie shell. Today, you will make a hasty decision that will change your life. Damn, Charles thought, that one was different. It seemed benign on the surface. Everyone made decisions that changed their life, didn't they? The message wasn't the weird part, though. It was the sinister undertones that Charles couldn't quite shake. Not just any decision, but a hasty one. He ate the other half of the cookie before adding this one to the corkboard, looking at the phone number that sat under the lucky numbers. Want more cookies? Call 1-800-555-2665. Charles grinned, turning back to his desk as he opened the rest of his food and began to eat. Who wouldn't want more cookies? Charles worked well into the night. By 11, he had fixed the problem in the code his boss had sent him. One of the other coders had been a little sloppy in the parameters, and as a result, had caused the program to crash as often as it returned anything usable. Charles had fixed it, emailing his boss about 10, and had started bumming around on Reddit as he thought about what to do with the rest of his evening. He wasn't ready to turn in yet, but he wasn't really interested in any of the games he had in his Steam library. He was just kind of wasting time as he scrolled through Reddit when he came to a weird post about strange phone numbers. The poster was talking about how he had called a number he'd found and how the guitar instructor had turned out to be a real creep. They claimed he had later seen the man on America's Most Wanted, but Charles thought the last bit sounded like bullshit. The comments mostly agreed, but some of them had talked about other weird numbers they had called. Massage parlors that had turned out to be brothels, contractors that had later robbed the house they had renovated, weird number stations that called back when you hung up, everything in between. The more he read, the more Charles thought about the number on the fortune cookie. It couldn't hurt to call. Maybe it would even give him a cool story to tell the strangers on the internet. He walked over to the board, cell phone clutched in hand, as he read that old familiar legend again. Want more cookies? Call 1-800-555-2665. Charles dialed the number in that stilted way that people do when they dial a new number. He had to go back and try it again after putting the number in wrong the first time, and when it started ringing, Charles assumed that a machine would get it. They would probably just bury him in a phone tree, and he would never actually talk to a real person. Either that, or the number would ring twice and then tell him it had been disconnected. They had probably had these cookies out for a while, and the number would have changed or been liquidated altogether. The third ring had barely started when a bored-sounding woman picked up the phone. Hello? Charles blinked, and the woman had said hello once more before he finally shook it off and answered her. Yeah, I was calling about the cookies. Wonderful. We'll send them right out. Don't you need my address or my... No, sir. It's all taken care of. Thank you for your call. Then she hung up, and Charles was left staring out into space. Well, that had been weird, he thought. He figured it might be time to get ready for bed. The phone call had weirded him out, and he had another long day tomorrow. As he snuck down under his covers, he couldn't help but glance over at the fortunes on the corkboard. He wondered how long it would take them to send the cookies to his house. Would they send them all at once, or would this be a situation where they sent a few at a time? He fell asleep dreaming of the buttery little fortune cookies, and when he woke up, he decided that he must still be dreaming. His hands wrapped around the plastic film of a single fortune cookie, and as he opened it, he could smell the flaky aroma of the pastry inside. When he broke it open and felt the crumbs fall onto his chest, he opened his eyes and realized that it was no dream. The fortune cookie was tucked under his pillow, as if the tooth fairy had left him a buttery treat instead of a quarter. Charles looked at the fortune as he ate and was surprised to find not a fortune, but a thank you note. Thank you for your business. That was when he remembered the phone call from the night before. It was weird, but he couldn't see how the two could be connected. He must have just imagined eating the fortune cookie last night. Charles had no idea how it had gotten in his bed, but it was a nice surprise, nonetheless. He put in a call to Damien's, and when he sat down on the couch, the phone ringing as someone no doubt ran to grab it, he heard the crinkle of cellophane from under the couch cushions. Reaching under the cushion, Charles found another wrapped cookie, this one slightly broken from being sat on. Hello, Charles, you ordering? Damien's voice brought Charles back to reality, and he munched on the cookie as he placed his morning order. He was soon eating his breakfast, the cookie out of his mind, but he would think back on that day and decide that that had been the first appearance of the strange cookies. The next day, Charles found 12 individually wrapped cookies. They were all scattered around the apartment. They were tossed haphazardly around, some under the couch, some as far as the kitchenette. Charles couldn't exactly put them off as something he'd forgotten or misplaced. How had they gotten so spread across the living room? Then his eyes fell on a small takeout bag in the trash, and he felt like he knew the answer. Roger had delivered his food this morning, and he remembered telling him about the number he'd called to get more cookies. Roger had said it sounded a little spooky, and told him to let him know when the cookies arrived. Charles had gone to get his wallet so he could pay him, leaving Roger at the door. That must have been when he'd tossed the cookies into his house, probably thinking he was being funny. Charles nodded as he collected up the cookies, the explanation reassuring him until he remembered that it was almost time for dinner. Roger had delivered his food around 11, so how did Charles not notice the cookies for 8 hours? He put it out of his mind as he picked up the phone so he could order the dinner. The next day, Charles found 20 of the cookies scattered around his house again. Not all at once, of course. Charles had sat down to eat his breakfast when he found the first one under the couch. Then he stumbled across the line of 10 or 12 cookies stretched over the couch and to the far side of the kitchenette. They looked tossed haphazardly, and he gritted his teeth as he imagined Roger smirking as he covertly threw a handful of cookies into the apartment. He picked up one of the cookies, preparing to call Damien's and tell Roger how he'd gotten him good, when he remembered that Roger hadn't delivered his meal this morning. Roger wouldn't be there till noon today, and the other guy hadn't even known about the number. But if it wasn't Roger, then who else could it be? He tried to put it out of his mind, but when he found 4 more in the bathroom sink and 3 more in his bedroom, it was harder to overlook. He found more in the bathtub, but by then, any thought that it might be a joke was over. None of the delivery guys could have gotten this far into his apartment. He was more confused than scared, but Charles really wanted some answers. When he called to place his lunch order, he was surprised to find Damien answering the phone again. Surprised, but not unhappy. The usual, Damien asked. and Charles could already hear his pencil scratching. Yeah, but I got a question. We don't do discounts for frequent customers, Damien joked, but he must have heard something he didn't like in Charles's voice. No, nothing like that. I was wondering about where you get your fortune cookies from. My uncle orders them. Why do you ask? Well, I've recently started finding them around my house. It was just a few yesterday, but they were all over the house today. I found 20 of them so far, and the fact that no one's been in my house since right after COVID started is a little... But Damien cut him off. The usual good-natured ribbing was gone. Charles believed that this was the most serious he'd ever heard Damien. You called the numbers on the cookies, didn't you? Charles' mouth went dry as he heard Damien get to the point. Yeah, but I haven't gotten any cookies delivered. They just keep appearing in my house. I don't understand how this is happening, but I want to know how they're getting in. He was silent for a few seconds, and Charles thought he had hung up. When he spoke, Charles suddenly wished he had. You can't stop it. There's no taking it back once the deal is made. He hung up on Charles then, and they refused to take his calls. Charles was on his own, it seemed. On the third day, Charles found his couch covered in cookies, and he estimated there were about 50 in all. That was when Charles called the police. They came out and checked the house, but they couldn't find any sign of entry. Charles showed them the cookies, telling them how they had just appeared in the middle of the night, but he could tell they didn't believe him. They thought he was playing a joke, one at their expense, too, and they clearly didn't appreciate it. They told him they would look into it and to call back if it happened again, but Charles figured they would be another group that would ignore his phone calls. He tried to call Damien again, but no one picked up. He locked all the doors before bed, ensuring every window was secured and checked every point of entry. He had told himself the night before that if it kept happening, he would get the landlord to change the locks. How else could they be getting in? This had to be a trick. Someone had too much time and they wanted to play a trick on him. Whether they were pranksters or not, Charles wanted this to stop. Charles lay on the couch, all the cookies swept into a pile in the corner, and hoped they would just be gone when he woke up in the morning. He awoke to find the floor of his apartment covered in the little yellow cookies. They crackled angrily as he set his feet down on them, and when he stood up, they were up to his ankles. As he trudged through them, he saw they covered the floor from the living room to the bedroom. The bathroom door opened with some pushing, and as he waded through them so he could use the toilet, Charles was racked with a sudden wave of angry coughs. He felt something tickle at the back of his throat, and was certain for half a second that he was going to throw up. His urine trickled to the floor as he hit his knees, and when the thing splashed into the toilet, Charles felt something cold squirm in his guts. The cookie floated in the filthy water like a strange buoy in an alien sea. As he watched it bob there, Charles made a decision that would change the rest of his short life. He slid his shoes on and left the house for the first time in months. The bell rang as he walked into Damien's, and the staff's smiling faces curdled as they saw him. Charles sat at the table he had taken every time he had eaten here. The staff went about their jobs, actively avoiding him, but Charles wasn't going anywhere. He knew that Damien had answers. He knew something, and he'd sit here until he got what he was after. Even if it was Damien telling him how exquisitely screwed he was, he was going to get some answers. Damien let him sit there for close to an hour, before finally coming out. I told you there was nothing I could do. You've been cursed. Don't you understand that? The least you could do is not spread it around. You know something about this, though, Charles said, glaring at him from between his steepled fingers, and I'm not leaving until I get some answers. Damien turned his head away, seeming to think about it before finally telling Charles to wait. Without you calling in an order at 10, I can finally close this place up on time. Wait till then, order whatever you want, and I'll take you to someone who has answers. Charles scoffed. I can't just sit here all day. Damien only shrugged. If you want answers, then I guess you'll have to. With little choice but to wait, Charles ordered some lunch. The staff kept his drink full, and Damien was true to his word. Charles ate when he was hungry, drank when he was thirsty, and used their facilities sparingly. He couldn't help but imagine his poor apartment as it filled up with the buttery little cookies, and the longer he sat, the more anxious he became. Where was Damien taking him later? Who would explain the situation? Someone else who had called the number? As the sun set behind him, Charles wanted to go with him less and less, but knew that he needed to more and more. As the crowds faded and the restaurant emptied, Damien finally came out and told him it was time to go. We can take my car, he said. indicating a small hatchback out front. The car ride was short. They drove a few streets towards a small cluster of family homes that ended in a cul-de-sac. Charles could see several people wave at Damien as he drove towards the house at the end of the turnabout, and the sight of that place made him a little wary. Where the others had well-maintained lawns and houses that looked well-kept, this house they stopped in front of looked old and ready to fall down. The grass was mostly sand, patchy and limp, and the front porch was covered in boxes that looked ready to be shipped. The place looked abandoned, like a hoarder's house, but Charles could see people coming and going through the front door, most of them carrying boxes like the one on the porch. Damien killed the engine and looked at Charles. "You sure you want to know? It won't change your fate." Charles nodded, unable to damn himself with his words, and Damien climbed out and set off towards the house. Charles followed meekly enough after, but it wasn't until he got to the porch that he realized what those boxes were. He didn't need to read the foreign characters to know what was inside. The open box contained a bunch of familiar yellow cookies that Charles had come to hate. Whoever owned this house was packaging the fortune cookies in boxes. When Damien opened the door, a cascade of wrapped fortune cookies slithered onto the porch. "It's even worse than usual," Damien mumbled, wading into the sea of cookies as he beckoned Charles forward. The inside was even worse. The house was full of boxes, and the pair had to wade through the hip-deep sea of fortune cookies. Charles could see others wading through them, shoving them into boxes as they took them out. Charles could see a kitchen and a den as they waded through the house, and Damien seemed to be leading him towards the back. As they made their way down a hallway towards the back bedroom, the cookies got thicker and thicker. Damien knocked on the door, calling out a name Charles didn't understand. "Uncle?" Damien asked, a strange gurgling coming from inside. "Uncle, I got a guest who wants to meet you. May we come in?" There was another gurgling response, and Damien invited Charles inside. Charles was surprised to find not a room full of cookies, but a neat and tidy bedroom. Inside was an elderly man in striped pajamas, his dark hair plastered against his skull, and his unreadable eyes floating dully in his wrinkled face. His sallow skin clung to his bones like a bleached corpse, and if he hadn't turned to acknowledge Damien, Charles would have thought he was dead. "Good to see you again, Uncle," Damien greeted him. "This is my uncle, Dallin. He once owned the restaurant that I own now, but he made a miscalculation. He was trying to cut costs, and when he saw that he could get more cookies by calling the number, he gave it a try. At first it was wonderful. Dallin had enough cookies to stock the store for months, and he was glad for the windfall. Soon, the cookies started taking over his house, though. They covered the floors, they crept up to the ceiling, they spilled into the yard, and finally, they started filling him, too." The words sent a chill through Charles, but he had to be sure of what he was hearing. "When you say they filled him, what do you..." Dallin coughed suddenly, deeply, a racking cough that shook his whole body. Charles took a step towards the sick man, but Damien put a hand out to stop him. The old man crossed his arms over his chest, trying to steady himself, and bent low over the comforter. As the coughs became thick, Charles thought the old man meant to bring something up. Then he lunged forward suddenly. Charles watched as a cascade of cellophane-wrapped cookies fell onto the bedspread. He began to tremble, just like the one he had brought up earlier that day. "So," Charles said, having to swallow a mouthful of spit, not having the moisture to speak more than a few words, "so I'll start doing that too?" Damien nodded, putting a hand on his shoulder. "I'll have some of my people come over to pick up the cookies they leave behind. We can pay you for them, hopefully making it a little easier for you. Eventually we can bring you here. You can live in comfort for however long you have left, but eventually, you'll be no different than my uncle here." Charles stood for a minute, unable to come to terms with what he was seeing. He wanted to deny what Damien had said. He wanted to tell him how it just couldn't be real. But then his body was consumed with vicious coughs, as if to prove how real it was. A single cookie pattered to the floor at his feet, and Charles realized it was already too late.
Good evening, everyone. It's me, Dr. Plague. Thank you so much for joining me for tonight's story.
If you enjoyed tonight's story, why not go ahead and subscribe if you're not already subscribed? Maybe hit that notification bell so you don't miss any of the spooky stuff we do here. If you'd like to get a copy of my latest book, there's a link below. Or if you'd like to support the show more monetarily, you can always come down to Patreon. I have many tiers, I'm sure you'll find something that interests you. If you're interested in my books, I always recommend my Ghostly Reader tier. Ghostly readers get a copy of my book signed on their doorstep anytime I write one, which is at least twice a year. Patrons always get their spooky a little bit early, so they can enjoy them before that night's premiere. And speaking of patrons, let's go ahead and thank them. Thanks to Janet and Winters for being our Spooky Skeleton Tier contributors, and thanks to Zeronin, Emily Coltsfoot, Martha, Marianne Schuler, Jennifer Damron, and Tyler Parker for being our Ghostly Reader Tier contributors. Thanks, guys. We just couldn't do the show without you. I'm sure by now you can see some videos appearing at the end here. If you think you might like a little more spooky, why not go ahead and click on another one? I'm sure you can handle a little bit more. And as always, thanks for stopping by. Dr. Plague, signing off. Have a wonderful evening.